Good morning.
Good morning.
Forgot which hat I was supposed to have on there for a minute. Good to see you this morning and welcome each of you to Lester Memorial United Methodist Church. Glad to have you here and welcome to our radio and television congregation. We're glad to have you worshiping with us as well also. Got a pretty full slate of things going on in the church this week. I want to call some of them to your attention. First one, that's where I was checking on it. We've got a, it's not a card, but a banner, whatever you want to call it, but for each of you to sign as you leave church today, a get well thing for Dr. Joe Tipton back here on the table, and someone will deliver it to him. But please put your name on there and whatever thoughts you have, and someone will get it to Joe, and I'm sure he would appreciate it. This, not in any particular order, but today, I reminded you last week, the Skyler and Casey are having open house from 12 until 2. And I told you they were having just stuff just like pheasant and underglass duck, prime rib and all that. I stand corrected on that. I think there will be maybe some finger food and snacks and all. But anyway, once you go and visit open house from 12 until 2, then you need to hurry back up here and grab some valet parking and get ready for the Blount County. As Joe said, we call it the Blount County singing, because it will be a singing for those of you who have never been here and heard that. Methodists are not known too much for dancing in the aisles. There'll be a few Methodists here and they probably won't dance, but honest to goodness, some of the music will move you to where you want to shout and do whatever. It's a great thing. So get here early, get a good seat. If you get here late and you don't see a seat, we've got plenty next door in the fellowship hall. We have a live feed over there, and it's probably a little cooler, but there's nothing like the real thing being here in the sanctuary. So take that into consideration. The Friday prayer breakfast, student prayer breakfast, start back this Friday in the fellowship hall next door. I'll remind you of that. I've been told to announce that the fall literature is downstairs. That's where it's been ever since I can remember. I don't know why they wanted to announce it, but maybe because I think it was running a little late and some of you had wondered where the literature was, but it's in the same place that it's always been. I'll remind you about the ongoing Bible studies. It's 10 o'clock this Monday. Tuesday evening of this week, we'll have an administrative council meeting here in the sanctuary with some important information pertaining to our building program. 6:30. At 6:30, yeah, 6:30 here in the sanctuary. There'll be a fundraising going on in the fellowship hall at that time for the Oneonta Marching Band. Our Wednesday night dinners begin cranking back up this week at 5:15. And Young at Heart meets this Thursday at 11:30 in the fellowship hall. That's kind of a mouthful, but this is a busy church, and glad that we're all a part of it. Glad you're here this morning. May God truly bless us during this hour of worship. Thank you.
Good morning. Our first hymn in the Cokesbury is 110. He keeps me singing, and let's just do the first, third, and fifth verses. 110.
As you know, this is camp meeting month, and we have someone to share a testimony about what God has been doing in their lives recently. And today, Annie Perrin is going to share with us.
Good morning.
Good morning.
For those of you who don't know me, I am Annie Perrin Grisham. My mom and I have been going here since I was in kindergarten, and I'm now a senior at Aniana. I sing in the church choir, and I'm a member of our church's youth group. I've participated in various missions opportunities through the church for many years, including going to the Philippines. But today I'm here to talk about my experience at ASP this past summer. I first attended ASP the summer before my junior year, so two summers ago. I attended not really knowing anybody that was going, and just going off of the nudge that one gets when God wants you to do something. And I also might add a strong nudge from Christine Neal Brooks. For those who don't know, ASP is an organization through which youth and adult leaders work on houses to make them warmer, safer, and drier for the low-income families of Appalachia, while also ministering the word of God to those families. If you can't tell, it's a pretty big job, especially for a girl who had never picked up a power tool before going on this trip. Nevertheless, I came back that summer with a new appreciation and a post-hole digger and an amazing bond with my adult leaders and youth group, a new appreciation for God's love for me and the woman's house we worked on, and a feeling that this was the awesomest trip ever. And I would like to go back next year with all of my friends in tow. That brings us to this summer. I was in upstate New York, basically on the border of Canada, visiting colleges. When I got the call, boom, my grandfather, Terry Sellers, had passed away. We were informed by my aunt to get home straight away, and that they didn't know how he had died, just that he had died suddenly and peacefully. We drove for two straight days, and while the rest of the youth was preparing their packing list for ASP, I was helping prepare a funeral. After the funeral, I had my doubts about going on the trip. There was, after all, so many thank you notes to write and my grandmother to comfort. I, however, believe that my grandfather's spirit, which was that of a true servant his whole life, nudged me to go, and in the end, as it is written, you will experience all these blessings if you obey the Lord your God. Long story short, I packed the night before the trip and embraced it with an open heart, an open mind, and although I didn't know it yet, by opening up a window. Now, my friend Hannah spoke at the 8:30 service, and I want to talk a little bit about what we did. Our homeowner, Ms. Copeland, she had four windows on the side of the house we were working on, and they were basically falling out. The inside of her house, where the windows were, was basically covered with blankets and duct tape, keeping her out of the cold and the wind and the rain. We pulled out all those windows. Some of them literally just came out, and then we had to put new windows back in, but we had a little roadblock, as Hannah said, and the windows were too big. So we had to enlarge the window frame by 5 inches, which is pretty big. And then we finally got them in there. Thought we weren't gonna do it, but we finished early and we were like, hey, we can put some siding on too while we're at it. So we actually got done with more than what we'd planned. And now I'd like to give some thanks where thanks are needed. First, to a nail picker-upper, because if you take out a window on a house, you're bound to drop a lot of nails, especially if you were me. Second, to Ms. Copeland, my homeowner, for showing me that truly the least of these will come first in the kingdom of God, and having the selfless spirit that so reminded me of my grandfather. Third, to Neil and Christy Brooks, for nudging me to go on the trip the first time around and being an example to all the kids in the youth group. Next, to Marla Smith, one of my group leaders, for providing me with an example of how a true, strong Christian woman acts and the mentality that you should never give up and act positive always, even in 100-degree weather. Next to Max Moody, who, with his master carpentry skills, allowed us to finish our project, even though we were late to supper the last day, proving the statement, better late than never. Next to those friends I was talking about that I dragged in tow this year, first to Sydney, for always being that friend that you go to with all your problems and who always has an open ear to listen, even though she's probably still scared of using a hammer to this day. Next to Imwall, Macy, who is my cuddle buddy, who braided my hair every morning on ASP, and who is willing to get up on the really high ladder when everybody else didn't want to. And Hannah, who probably saved my life by telling me it was not the smartest thing to jump the fence and go pet the cows. I'm so thankful that I can now call these girls my best friends, and I can proudly say that they are good Christian friends, and I can count on them for anything, and I'm proud to say that I got closer to them on ASP. I'm thankful for just the ASP program, really, and how they brought the youth group and our amazing new youth pastor, Skylar, together. And I'm thankful for the church and church family, for your prayers, and for allowing us to go on this trip. And last but not least, I almost forgot, I'm thankful for Billy Bob Barnett, who was the other group leader, whose excellent brake check and horn honking skills saved us from a near-death experience with a deer, and whose very long sermons, yes, I said sermons, probably lost us an hour of sleep at night and an hour of work time during the day, but whose sermons we will always be thankful for and remember forever. We are very thankful for Bill because we know that he doesn't have to go on these trips. After all, he doesn't have any kids in the youth group. But we know that he goes because he sees God through the homeowners and through us, the kids that he so loves and ministers to. But the love is two-sided because we love and appreciate him too, and he blesses us just with his mere sarcastic presence. So thanks, Bill.
Don't kill it all.
And last but not least, I thank God. I thank him for my life and everything and everybody in it. And I thank him for allowing me to see his truths on this trip. Thanks and glory be to him now and forever. Amen.
Billy Bob. That's a good southern name, Bill. As we turn our thoughts toward our prayer time, I encourage you to look at the list that's in your bulletin. Obviously, pray for the family and friends of Kenny Chesser at his funeral Thursday. Please remember Rita and the family as they go through this. Also, the family of Velvie Lyles, Richard Calvary, mother-in-law, Katrina's mom that passed away and was buried yesterday. And also, like Brother Mike Brinkman's been going through some travails and trials lately, please remember Mike in your prayers. And Kathy's having some surgery this week, so remember both of them in your prayers. I don't know who's going to take care of who in that family, but
we'll manage.
You'll manage. Okay. Please remember them in your prayers. And also, Dr. Joe Tipton. Just pray for Dr. Joe. You know the situation, but he has made some improvements, so we just ask you to remember him in your prayers and also the others on our prayer list. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, thank you for the day. Thank you, God, for your great love for us. Lord, what a tremendous witness we just heard about how you are at work through our young people in our church and some who are a little older. God, we thank you for all the efforts that go forth to minister to people's needs, and we thank you, God, that we're able to do that. Lord, we do want to pray for those who've lost loved ones. We ask for your comfort and your strength. Lord, in the difficult days ahead, it's such a hard time when we have to say goodbye to somebody we love. And so, God, we ask that you just bring comfort and strength to each one. God, we'd also pray today for those who are on our prayer list who are going through difficulties right now. God, we pray that you'd bring healing, and God, that you'd touch each one of them, Lord, in a special way so that they would know that you're with them, God, as they're going through their struggles. And God, we absolutely trust their healing to your care. We ask, God, for you to be with the men and women serving in our military. God, we ask that you bless them and their families while they're separated. Protect them, God. Bring them home safe. And Lord, we pray that that there would be an end to war. God, we pray that the Prince of Peace would rule throughout our world. And Lord, I pray that first of all, the Prince of Peace would rule in our lives. God, may we find your peace and may we share that peace with others. Lord God, we thank you, we love you, we praise you, God, for our worship time today. And now we join in praying as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
We're just going to do two requests this time, and I've already had one during Sunday school. So let's start with page 6, Holy, 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 and we'll do the first and last verse, and then somebody call out a number, and we'll do that one. Number 6, Holy, Holy, Holy. First and last of 158, we have a story to tell.
Oh,
ushers to come forward. You know, I love the words of that song, "We've a Savior to show to the nations." And we're the only ones going to do that, the body of Christ. Let's pray. Well, God, as we come to this point of worshiping you with our tithes and offerings, God, we ask you to bless the offerings into your kingdom. God, may we be wise stewards of what you entrust our care. And God, may we use what you place in our hands to expand your kingdom. And we pray this in Christ's name. Amen. As the choir is preparing to sing, I want to go ahead and introduce Gary McGill so he can come as soon as the choir finishes. But Gary and I have been known each other and been friends for about 40 years or so. And you remember we had Renee McGill on our prayer list that we prayed for a long time. And a few weeks ago, Renee went to be with the Lord. And a few days after that, Gary came by to see me and said he had a message that he wanted to share with the congregation, because he said he had never seen such faith. And so we worked out a time to do that on this day. Several people asked me why I wasn't preaching, but it's because Gary has a word that he wants to share with our congregation. And when the choir finishes, Gary, you come on up, okay?
And also, one thing about this afternoon, remember we have visitors coming. They'll be coming probably as y'all are leaving. But if you can neaten up things, take your bulletins or put them in the trash or put everything to the end, then we can put them under the benches and try to make as much room as we can. But come if you can this afternoon. I think you'll really enjoy it.
Better get ready, 'cause I'm giving you the warning. Everybody's gonna have a wonderful time. Ryan and I, we won the tournament, and I can remember really the first time I really got back to playing Rook was with Barry, I think about 43 years ago. So I owe everything to you, Barry, on my Rook skills. As Barry said, I got with him one day about 4 weeks ago, and I told him I had a message of about a young lady that really had a great influence on my life, especially in the last year and a half. That was my daughter-in-law, Renee Turner McGill. I had never seen such courage, such strength and faith in a young lady. Even when she was fighting a deadly disease like cancer, who gives you no quarter at all, it will destroy everything it can. When I first met Renee, she was somebody that I felt very fortunate to meet, which was about 9 years ago when my son brought her home to introduce her to me and my family. She was happened to be someone, as time went by, that made me realize that the problems I had at the time were quite small. She was someone that made you want to count your blessings and to do and try to do your best every single day of the year. She was the type of person that could walk in her room and light it up like a Christmas tree. She would share that warmth and that Christian faith she had. I felt very fortunate to hear her talk about the Lord. Renee, she died on July the 5th, 2016. I felt very fortunate in knowing her, but I went a step forward. I actually put her on my hero list. Yes, as a young man growing up in the 50s, I'm 72 years old. I started a hero list, and I had various people in there. I had my dad on that list. But I added Renee to that list, and I wondered what really was a good definition of a hero. I looked in dictionaries and on the internet, and I really didn't like the sound of what they presented as a hero. So I looked around and found an old friend of mine that provided me with a good definition of what a hero was. I got it from Superman. He provided me with a great definition of what a hero. Now, to me, Superman was Christopher Reeves. I always think, when I think of Superman, I think of Christopher Reeves. And I think we all know what happened to Christopher. He had a bad break in life. But here's what Superman said a hero was. It was just an ordinary person who finds strength and courage to persevere and endure in spite of overwhelming obstacles. Now, I think we all know that Not all heroes live. I guess the first experience was when I was in college taking ROTC. And my company commander was a young man from Birmingham named Felix King. I was a freshman and Felix was a senior. He looked like a soldier. He was tall, about 6'4", 220 pounds, just a awesome, good-looking man. But later on, I heard that Felix was killed in Vietnam. But he wasn't killed by the enemy. Not in a traditional way of a bullet. But Felix fell on a grenade and saved the lives of 14 members of Charlie Company. I put him on my hero list. Then there was Jesus Christ. As a young man, decided to devote my life to Christ at the age of 13. I saw what he endured. He gave his life so that we might live eternally. Now, when I was at the funeral of Renee, I heard some people talking, saying, well, you know, Renee got a bad break in life. So young, just 32 years old, had fought cancer for a year and a half. That made me go back to another hero of mine. Going back in the 50s. I love to go to the library because in my community that I grew up in, a little, I called it a suburb of Birmingham, a little place called Central Park. The only air-conditioned place in the whole community was a library. So I went to the library a lot. And I read about this hero. Back in 1922, a man named Wally Pipp was talking to his manager, Joe McCarthy. And he told Coach that, I don't believe I can play today. I'm not feeling well. I've got this severe migraine. I've taken medication, but it doesn't seem to have helped at all. And I just don't think I can give you 100% today, Coach. Well, Coach McCarthy, he did everything he could to try to persuade Wally to go ahead and play. He said, I really need you. Our most hated rivals coming into Yankee Stadium, Boston Red Sox. I need you, Wally. Just don't think I can do it, Coach. Coach McCarthy looked at him and said, You see number four over here at the end of the bench? He sure has been wanting to get in the starting lineup. And he sure has looked good at practice lately. You might want to change your mind. Well, Wally just laughed at him and said, Coach, he'll never make a ball player. He's a mama's boy. And you know about mama's boys. They just don't have the fortitude and the guts to play this game of baseball. A rough and tumble game. do anything to win. You know, he won't even go, after we play a game, he won't even go out with the guys and have a few beers and chew a little tobacco and maybe gamble a little, playing cards. He goes home to his mama. But there's other reasons, Coach, that he's not going to make much of a ball player. He's an Ivy Leaguer. He went to one of those Ivy League schools, Columbia. I've never known an Ivy Leaguer making a good baseball player. And beside that, he's a Jew. We don't like Jews. Well, he's not going to make a baseball player. I'm really not worried. Okay, I don't see things like that, Wally, but number four, come here. You're in the lineup today. And history was made. In fact, number four went out and hit two doubles for 17 years. He never missed a game. 2,130 games in a row. 497 home runs. He hit four home runs in a game, which is a rare, rare feat. Knocked in 184 RBIs in 1932. Hit 12 home runs in World Series play. Considered the greatest first baseman that's ever lived. Wally Pipp. We never heard of Wally again. Wally was traded to the Cincinnati Reds. Number four, became the greatest first baseman that ever lived. Played for probably the greatest baseball teams that have ever lived, the New York Yankees. But sometimes in life, all good things must come to an end. Number four, in 1937, in spring training, for some reason, his coordination didn't seem to be the same. The swing didn't seem to be the same that he was used to. In the first 10 games of the season, he was 2-for-22. That was not like number four. He went to the Mayo Clinic. Found out he had a muscle disease. It slowly would destroy his muscles and take his life. Yes, Lou Gehrig. He was number four. Well, on a hot July the 4th, 1937, they were going to celebrate Lou Gehrig's life and all his accomplishments, all the thrills that he gave the fans. Various speakers came to the microphone and told how much they cared about Lou, and praised his baseball skills. Even Babe Ruth said kind words about Lou, and they didn't exactly get along. Lou really didn't want to say anything at this celebration because he didn't think he could. He was all choked up. In fact, he barely made it on the field. But the fans, They kept hollering, "We want Lou, we want Lou." Joe McCarthy, his manager, whispered in his ear, "Joe, you can do this." He picked up the microphone. Cleared his throat, and he looked at the 65,000 fans that had came to Yankee Stadium that day and the millions that were listening on the radio. He said, "I know for the last 2 or 3 weeks you guys have all heard that I've had an unlucky break in life. But I don't see it that way. I actually, at this time in my life, I feel like I'm the luckiest man on earth." Knowing that he was going to die, knowing that his baseball career had come to an end, he felt like he was the luckiest man in the world at 37 years old. He said, "How can't I be lucky? Just look at all these wonderful fans that I played, and they came out to watch me. And all my good friends, my players." Because it didn't take long for those baseball players to have the greatest respect for Lou Gehrig. All it took was a few doubles and home runs, and things sure did change for Lou. They didn't care what religion he was. He said he had a wonderful wife, a wonderful parents, and he had this love for God. Even though he didn't speak much about his religion or his faith, but he had that deep love for God that he didn't talk much about. Now, Renee McGill, I have never seen in such a long time a person that had as much faith as Renee did. She turned 32 on May the 28th, 2016, which was just about 6 weeks before she died. And at her birthday party, she was having a pretty good day. Probably was the last good day of her life. But she felt so good, she was telling everybody, "I'm going to come back to work. I'm going back to work. I feel so good today. The Lord has blessed me on this day. I'm going to make it back to work. I'm needed at work." Of course, things didn't turn out that way, but 8 days before she died, she told my son, "I want to go to church." Even though she didn't feel good, she was in pain, but she wanted to be in the house of the Lord. Renee attended the First Methodist Church of Tuscaloosa. She wanted to go to church. So my son took her to church. And when she came home, my son said, "She was filled with the Holy Spirit." She told my son, "I have fought the good fight. But I'm going home. She loved my son. She told me that on many occasions because Renee stayed with me and my wife many weeks while she was sick. You know, I found out, even though I'm 72 years old, it's really not how long you live. It's what you do with the time that you're here. It's that little dash between 1984 and 2016. Renee's legacy was one where I'll show you my faith by my works. Now, Renee loved to go on the Emmaus walk. She loved that better than anything. I know she went three or four times here in Alabama and went to Georgia with her boss, Dr. Johnson, and they went to an equivalent of what we call Emmaus Walk. I'm not sure what the name of, I don't remember the name of it over there, but she went with him twice over in Georgia. She loved to be around Christian people and around the Lord. Generous to a fault. Heard my son trying to get on their feet. And she was giving money to people, to charities, when really she didn't have the money to give. Working in the soup kitchens in Birmingham, gathering supplies at the First Methodist Church in Tuscaloosa to send to our troops in Afghanistan. These were the things that she was doing all the time. What was so impressive at Renee's funeral, my son being a football coach, was when 87 Hillcrest High School football players came in single file with their jerseys on and marched through the funeral home and all sat down. They cared about Renee. They had their first football game Thursday night, played Demopolis. And on their helmet, they put RM, Renee McGill. They were going to play each game for Renee because Renee was always there for them at every ball game. Well, I went to my computer and I was able to pull up the ball game and I watched it. And of course, my son had already sent me a picture of the helmets. And I saw it. And they won the ball game. They beat Demopolis 42-7. They told me they were going to win 15 in a row for Renee. See, Renee would fill your bucket up. Literally fill your bucket up. See, Renee's legacy lives today. She was an organ donor. Now, they couldn't take her organs because of the cancer. But they took her eyes. And my son got a phone call from UAB saying two people can see, thanks to Renee. So her legacy, it lives on through two individuals who now can see. See, it truly is not how long you live, but what you do with the time you're here. I've known people that lived a long, long time. I never heard them say much of a kind word about anybody or anything. I try to stay away from those people. They're so negative about life. But yet, but Renee sure wasn't negative. She loved to read. The Bible was her favorite book. She took it almost everywhere she went. She even took it to work. And during her lunch break, would read the Bible. You know, she loved animals. She had these two cats, one named Ferguson and one named Mavis. And she had a husky dog named August. I don't know where she came up with these names, but they're very unusual. But she loved her cats. Mavis used to sleep with her. I would always see her on Renee's bed when we would go down, because she was bedridden for several months. Not that she couldn't get it out and walk, but she spent most of her time in bed. I remember she gave me this little note when I was at her house in Tuscaloosa, and it went, "You probably won't see me again soon, so you must have faith." I'll wait for the time when we can be together again. Until then, I want you to live your life the fullest. And if you need me, just whisper my name in your heart. And I'll be there. I'll be there for you. Now, when there's such an outstanding person like Renee, when the funeral's over and everybody goes home, and I went home, I have this prayer room that I've made, and Renee was the inspiration for that. I went down to my prayer room on Friday night. I wanted to have a talk with God. And I wanted to tell him how disappointed I was in him. How my heart was broke. How tired I was, how angry I was. I said, "Lord, did I not say the right words when I prayed to you to spare Renee? Did I say something that I shouldn't have? I have this angel. I love angels. In fact, I collect angels. I love them. And I had this angel, and there's an inscription on this angel. And it said that if tears could build a stairway, and memories a lane, I'd walk right up to heaven and take you back home again. That's how I felt. If I could just get to heaven, I'd bring you back down home again. And I told God this. Now, I guess I was going through one of those stages of when someone passes away. You always wonder why certain things happen, but I can't give you an answer to why. Anyway, I was sitting in my easy chair while I was talking to the Lord, and I looked over on my desk, and I saw this on my desk. It was a crucifix that my mother-in-law had given me. And I began to study it, and I looked at it, and I saw the suffering that Christ undoubtedly went through. One of the most horrible ways that a person can die. And it put back into perspective that my troubles weren't near as bad as I thought they were. And thoughts went through my mind, and I began to think, do you really know how much God loves each and every one of you? You can look at this, and that's your answer. For God so loved the world, He gave His only begotten Son. Now, I just, thoughts went through my mind, and I began to think, gosh, God had to sit there and endure and see His own Son put on a cross, iron spikes driven through His hands and feet, a sword punctured through His side. What love! What love! And then I begin to wonder about God. He wants us all to go to heaven. All of us. Whoever believeth in Him shall have everlasting life. You just have to believe. You ever wonder how generous God is? I looked at that crucifix again and again, and I said, God sure was generous. What did Jesus say? Forgive them, Lord, for they know not what they've done. All this in my prayer room, I ask God to forgive me for my doubt, my lack of faith, all because I looked at this crucifix and saw the pain that Christ undoubtedly went for all of us. And I know that Renee went through a lot of pain. Cancer never gave her a chance. It seemed like every time that she got to feeling good, then it would slam her down again. She laid unconscious for 5 days in Tuscaloosa Hospital because she was allergic to one of the chemo treatments that she was taking. She became allergic to it. She developed a blood clot in one of her legs where she couldn't walk. But she told my son, "I want to go to the beach. I want to go to Gulf Shores one more time." And they loaded up and they went to Gulf Shores and stayed for 4 days. She loved the sand. She loved the Gulf. So much faith, right to the very end. She still had faith that what was happening to her hopefully would have an effect on, I know it did on me. I know it did on me. Love is the greatest, to me, the greatest word in the world. And I love Jesus Christ. I have faith in Him. I have hope in Him. I have love in Him. A young 32-year-old girl strengthened my faith. Yes, she passed on, but I love her even more. And I know she's with the Lord. And I thank her for everything that she did for me. I'm like Lou Gehrig. I feel like I'm the luckiest man in the world to have known Renee McGill. Thank you so much. God be with all of you.
Probably all of us have gone through challenging times in our faith journey. And we never know exactly how we're going to feel about that, how we're going to get through. And yet God is there. He's the one constant through all that we experience. And Gary, thank you for sharing your faith journey. And I hope that somewhere along the way you've heard a word of encouragement for your own faith journey. Okay, I'm going to ask you to stand now. Lord God, we are grateful that for whatever we go through in life, you're there. And God, how we learn from others and how our lives are touched by others and how we discover a faith that goes beyond human reason. So God, we thank you for the word today. And I pray, God, that each one of us will hear in our own way the things you're saying to us today. In Jesus' name, amen. You're dismissed.